Okay, so I guess moving on now, we're going to have our student light speed talks or lightning talks. So some kind of 5-minute talks followed by 3 minutes of questions. So it's really exciting. We'll hear about four different PhD students who are going to talk about what they're working on. So I think we'll begin with Shilpi, if you're ready to go.
Is it 5 minute or 8 minute?
I guess you're given an 8-minute slot, but if you want to have some questions.
I'll share my screen.
I'll give you a heads up at 5 minutes. Sounds good. Looks good.
You can see my cursor, right?
Yep.
Okay. Hi, hello everyone. My name is Shilpi Bhunia, and I have started. I have my first PhD, first year PhD student at Dublin Institute for Advanced Studies. So today I'm going to give a talk on imaging of band splitting and fine structures of a type radio burst using the Murchison wide field array. So, So first I'll start with showing this movie of Vic CME, which draw a shock and caused a slow drifting radio features, which we call type 2 radio burst. And it has, like you can see here, it has two lengths of emission, which is we call fundamental and harmonic. Harmonic is basically the double of fundamental frequency. And because the plasma frequency is proportional to root over of electron density, so you can see it first appears at high frequency, means in lower corner where the electron density is high, and as time progresses, it moves to lower frequencies. Now, you can see, if you look closely at harmonic or maybe fundamental, you can see that their bands are splitted. And why so? Here we have a schematic illustration. So what we have here is an active region, and from this active region, the CME propagates, which caused a shock. And we can see here two almost co-spatial emission sources, which are from the two edges of shock front. And because this in this downstream region, the density is higher, so you have this upper frequency band. And from these upstream regions, we have this lower frequency band. And why they are important to study? Because studying them, we can get to understand the shock kinematics. Like for example, you can look calculate the density jump at shock, and from that you can get the Mach number, assuming that beta is almost to zero. And like I did it here and got some number, 1.3, and then from that, if you have shock speed and then Mach number, you can get the alpha speed. So yeah, so that's why it's very important to image the band splitting of a type 2 radio burst. So, okay, next, I wanted to give a brief overview of Murchison wide field array. So it's one of the escape precursor in Western Australia. It operates in 80 to 300 megahertz. And it has 128 tiles, which you can see here. Here we have the core. And one of the tile you can see here, 16 antennas in 4x4 grid range. And it has frequency resolution of 40 kilohertz and time resolution of 0.5 second. So to give a overview of the event we have on that day. So here we have a ghost X-ray flux plot, and we have this M5 point class flare peak, you can see, and followed by a CME, which caused a type 2 radio burst. And if you see these narrow boxes, so these are the regions which MW could detect. And here we have a nice movie of consecutive AI ratio images with three channels showing the eruption event. And okay. So what we have here is that this is the Learmonth dynamic spectrum. And these are the regions with six channels of MWA. And the points I chose, And you can see the radio contours on these AI images and the frequency and time of the radio contours you can see on this plot. So basically what they are training that, see, as time progresses, these contours are moving further away from the sun. So what we have here in this plot is, if you look closely in the harmonic part of the dynamic spectrum, you can see the band splitting, right? The upper frequency band and lower frequency band. So what I try to do is choose two frequency at same time and try to see what are they, where are they in on the AI image, you know? And what I, so after plotting this radio contours, I can see that they are slightly different in the position. And we know that this upstream and downstream regions, the emission sources caused by this upstream and downstream region should be at co-spatial location. So why this separation we see? So this is also one part of the future work I'll have. And next I'm going to talk about this fine structures in this type two we see. So one thing we, when you looked at these fine structures, we thought that maybe look at the location of this type two sources. Are they varying too much? Is this that causing these fine structures? So what we did first is that fit the Gaussian over the type two sources. And so
Shilpi, sorry, it's 5 minutes. So just.
Oh, yeah.
So you
yeah.
know, you're good.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So here you can see that how well fitted the Gaussian over the type two sources. And so it's a movie out from 8 frequency, and just to show that the fitting was good. And yeah, so what I have done in this plot is that, so the background dynamic spectrum is showing the peak amplitude of the Gaussian, and this arrows actually, the direction and the magnitude of the arrow shows the instantaneous shift in direction and magnitude in the Gaussian. So it was just showing the movement of the sources, you know. So this I have done for one channel. So next part will be doing that for every channels and try to see how they're moving, you know. So bit of what is my summary? So this is one of the few detailed spectroscopic imaging studies we have done for type 2 solar radio burst. And the one part will be to understand, to further investigate the fine structures in the type 2 region and why they are caused, like are they caused by the variations in these type 2, so in the location of type 2 sources? And if so, then we'll, what we'll do is we'll try to quantify those variations and understand the nature of the coronal turbulence. And then next, the next part will be, as I showed, that the locations, the source location caused by this upstream and downstream region of a shock should be at same position, but why we're seeing it in different locations. Yeah, so this is it.
Great, thank you so much, Shilpi. Does anybody have a quick question? I guess, this is really interesting work and fantastic plots and observations. I guess just in your last point there, do you usually see band splitting? Like, do you usually see those band splitting sources in different locations, or are they usually closer together?
So I can see, right? So the position in these two sources, you can see, right? They are in slightly different position, right? So the thing is that this upstream and downstream are coming from ahead and for behind of the shock front, right? And we know that the thickness of shock is very thin, right? So they should be at almost co-spatial locations, you know?
Yeah.
Not further. So that's what we are. They may be caused by scattering. Like in one recent paper, they have said that because of the scattering of this, what happens is that the upper frequency gets scattered less compared to the lower frequency, which is causing them to move further from each other. Like I had here.
Oh, yeah. Cool. Thank you so much. And if anybody has any other questions for Shilpi or comments, please put it in the chat. Okay, so thanks again, Shilpi. Jeremy, I think you're up next, if you're ready to go.
Yeah, okay.
Great. I'll send it to give you a shout at 5 minutes.
Yeah, perfect. Thanks.
Great. Thanks.
Just share slides. Okay, you can see all that, okay?
Yeah, looks good.
Great. Okay. Hi, everyone. My name is Jeremy, and I'm just going to go through a quick summary of the research that I'm doing. My project is titled Investigating M-Dwarf Stellar Flares with LOFAR ASCAP and TESS. And my supervisors, you can see here, and I am working with DIAS and our MAB observatory. So I'm just going to cover a little bit of an introduction on the background behind my research and where the data that I'm using is coming from and the two projects that I'm working on currently, and then I'll give a summary at the end. So to start, years, the 11-year solar cycle, which is characterized by an increase in sunspots and activity. Also, I apologize if my internet goes at any point, it's giving me a warning that it's unstable. But you have this period of activity where you have an increase in sunspots, and these are often defined as active regions where you get flares and CMEs occurring. And with these flares and CMEs, you get solar radio bursts, which you've heard about from type 1 up to type 4. And we see these regularly on the sun now that we have instruments like LOFAR. But then when we bring this to low mass stars, which are characterized as K, M, and L dwarf type stars, these stars are much cooler and redder than the sun. They're almost entirely convective, so they have no radiative core. And this, coupled with high rotation rates, means they have very high magnetic field strength, much higher than what we'd see on the sun. And then this leads to the increased presence of much larger star spots. So with the sun, you would have a sunspot that might cover maybe 0.5% of the solar disk, and star spots can cover 20% or even more of a low mass star stellar disk. And why are we interested in looking at stellar activity on M dwarfs? Well, they're particularly suitable for the detection of exoplanets via the transit method. Because they're very small, their planets typically orbit much closer, and the dip you would see in a light curve can be larger than planets which might orbit further out on larger mass stars. But typically, the habitable zone to date has been defined by more determinable factors like the surface brightness and the stellar radius of the star and surface temperature and so on. But only now are we starting to look at the activity on these stars as potentially impacting the stars, or the planets rather, that are in the habitable zones that we've defined so far. And so we're not sure if CMEs occur on these stars, if the emission can escape the high magnetic field strengths, and then that could lead to potentially irradiating the surface of close nearby exoplanets, or if this emission is continuous enough to sustain a habitable zone further out than we've currently defined. And so the data sources that I'm looking at are using the LOFAR radio telescope, which you've heard a lot about. I'm using the core stations, which have a 3 kilometer baseline in the Netherlands, and I'm using the high band arrays, so the higher frequencies from 120 to 200 megahertz. I'm also using ASCAP, or the Australian Square Kilometer Array Precursor Telescope, and that's an array of 36 dishes located in Australia. It's a survey telescope, so it has a very large field of view at 30 square degrees, and it operates from 700 megahertz to 1.8 gigahertz. And I'm also using data from the Transiting Exoplanet Sky Satellite, which is a telescope in space looking for exoplanets using the transit method. And it was specifically designed to look at M dwarf stars. So it looks in the redder region to the near infrared of the spectrum, 600 to 1000 nanometers. And it has a very, very large field of view, which you can see there. And what am I using this the data from these telescopes for? With the first project, it's looking at stellar flares from these stars to hopefully look for some radio emission in the lower frequencies. Now, research has been done on this before, in particular by Callingham et al. And Vedantam. So Callingham looked at CR Draconis, which is a very active M dwarf star in the near stellar neighborhood, and they detected radio emission. They actually managed to obtain dynamic spectra from a stellar flare from this star, and you can see that here in figure 5. And this was coincident with optical flare observations. So this can give information on the magnetic field strength of the star and the type of emission that's coming from it, and potentially whether a CME is occurring on these stars, so plasma emission from the surface. And then Vedantam et al, they looked at this quiescent M dwarf called GJ1151 and found continuous emission from the star over about eight hours. And they attributed this to potential interactions with a nearby orbiting exoplanet, which had not been detected and was later detected via follow-up optical observations. And so this sort of gives a flavor to the type of radio emission that you're able to detect with LOFAR from these stars. And so I'm using dedicated observations that were taken 48 hours using the LOFAR core, and the target is a highly active flare star, EV-LAC. And we have partial simultaneous optical observations from a telescope in Crimea.
So Jeremy, just have 5 minutes.
Oh, great. Okay, thanks. I'll try and fly through the rest. So, today we've tried imaging this field, and we haven't detected the star yet, but we're planning to try and do direction-dependent imaging to try and better calibrate the field and reduce the noise floor, essentially. And you can just see here, this is the snippet of the optical observations where there were flares during this time in optical. And my second project then is stellar flares using ASCAP and TESS. So there, again, has been previous research in this, not to go through too quickly, but they have detected a type 4 radio burst from Proxima Sen using ASCAP, coincident with optical flares. And so the current observations were target of opportunity with ASCAP and TESS. So we have two 13-hour observations, of a large field of view, and we're looking for multiple M dwarfs to detect flaring in as many as possible. And I'll just show this short video, which is very recent observation. This is preliminary, but just to show that we have test observations on the top right and a radio light curve from ASCAP on the bottom. And just coming up, you can see that there has been some radio emission detected from one of these M dwarfs, an M dwarf candidate in this field. From this data, and there seems to be no comparative optical data in tests. So this is something that we're investigating further, but it's a very interesting result to come out of this research to date. And so I'll just leave you with a summary of what I've done so far and what I'll be doing next. So thank you. And if you have any questions, I'm happy to try and answer them.
Great. Thank you so much, Jeremy. Does anybody have any questions or comments?
I have one. Sorry. So Jeremy, you're saying the flaring, I think it's EV-LAC, you're sort of limited by your calibration at the moment, is it?
It's actually, so I've only been doing direction independent image reduction at the moment. So I plan to do direction dependent to account for the LOFAR beam shape, because apparently that helps reduce the noise floor in images. I've seen it. It's been done in other research where they've detected very faint radio sources. It also might be the calibration, but it also, it might be the bandwidth. There's a lot of factors which I have to look at to try and improve the image quality in that data.
Cool, thanks. And Jeremy, you know that last movie you showed where you saw radio emission, but you didn't see anything in white light. Do you think that was a flare in the radio observations?
It's characteristic of a flare. There are actually three candidates where I've detected radio emission, and one of those has what appears to be a simultaneous optical flare, but two do not. One of them is more sustained, and this one, what you see, was a short burst. So it may be a flare event, but these are very recent. These have only come up in the last couple of weeks from analyzing this data. So there's a lot to try and figure out as to what might be the source of them. But I've been assured that it is real emission because it's far above the sensitivity threshold of the telescope. So, but as to why, as to precisely what is, I think that'll take more investigation, particularly with polarization, because this was taken in Stokes I, which I don't know if I mentioned, but it'd be good to see in Stokes V. Because the emission mechanism that the current working theory for emission mechanisms from these sources is that it's ECM, electron cyclotron maser, and that's highly circularly polarized. So if it's a flare, we might expect to see a very high emission in Stokes V also, but we haven't looked at that yet.
Oh, so interesting. It might make sense because we don't see a lot of white light flares. So maybe it's something there.
Perhaps, yeah.
Yeah, definitely. Well, thanks again. And again, if anybody has any other questions, please feel free to add them in the chat. So next up is Diana, if you're ready to go.
Hello, everyone. Can you hear me loud and clear?
Yeah, sounds good.
Okay, so let's start. My name is Diana Petkova, and I'm taking my PhD degree at Technical University of Sofia. Associated Professor Petr Petkov is my mentor and co-author of the research paper that I'm about to present. Let me just share it really quick. Okay, can you see it?
Yeah, looks good.
Okay. Okay, so when I analyze the performance of a single radiating element while rotating the coupling slot with respect to the feed line, that gives us a more array flexibility and provide us a building block for more complex antenna arrays, especially if we are talking about a series fed designs where it can be used to implement side lobe reducing amplitude tapering. So on the left picture, you can see the basic geometry. The aperture coupled patch antenna is a multilayer structure with no direct connection between the radiating element and the feed line. With a radiating surface and the feed line placed on the opposing sides of the PCB, the electromagnetic coupling is achieved through a rectangular cutout slot in the ground plane, which is situated in between them. Slot length, width, position, and angular rotation with respect to the feed line, of course, dictates how much the energy will be coupled into the antenna and how much of it will be radiated as a backslope. Maximum power transfer is achieved when the aperture is centered aligned with the patch element. The proposed model consists of patch element etched in the copper of the top layer and a substrate an air cavity and a copper ground plane with a coupling slot into it and a second dielectric layer on the bottom of the PCB. Great advantage of this multilayer structure is that the radiating element substrate and the substrate of the feed line can be chosen independently from one another in order to achieve a higher gain and a low back radiation in a single design. The selection of a thick low permittivity, the selection of a low permittivity. Okay, I don't know why some of the slides, it's not showing the rules of thumb, sorry. So I've written the rules of thumb that we used. I can tell because I don't know why they're not showing. The patch length and the substrate parameters dictate the patch center frequency. Its width should be less than twice its length because higher order modes appear when it's bigger. And as I mentioned, the ground plane has a cutout acting as a coupling slot between the feed line and the radiating element. This aperture adds a parasitic inductance to the feed line. And while increasing it, the slot area, it results in better coupling and higher gain at the cost of increasing the same parasitic inductance. And so by this, we are unmatching the design from the nominal input impedance. At some point, the impedance mismatch leads to the sharp decrease of the gain at the frequency due to the occurrence of secondary resonance. The slot length was determined to be a bit shorter than a lambda by 4 of the center frequency inside the substrate. Its width varies greatly in the literature, with the most common values being around 1/10 of its length. And after evaluating the width using FEM simulation, it was observed that a slightly wider aperture results in a better coupling and a lower backlobe radiation. To achieve stable impedance matching and good coupling factor, an open-ended microstrip step is used to terminate the transmission line after the coupling point using the optimization techniques. The step length was determined to be a bit less than L lambda by 4 from the central frequency. And here you can see the simulated results for the COPO. You can see that while we are rotating the slot, COPO radiation real light gain is dropping down. For the crosspole, we can say that at 60 degrees, it's almost minus 14 dB. And for the perpendicular, which is maximum, it's minus 50. And here on the Smith chart, we are using it to determine how good the impedance matching is. So you can see with rotating the slot how exactly it's like changing. And here is S11 as well. So yeah. The realized gain is determined the center of frequency and is plotted in a function of coupling swapped angle of rotation. By rotating the slot, it is possible to achieve the appropriate amplitude tapering. And backlop radiation is due to microstrip line radiation caused by impedance matching mismatching. After evaluating the slot rotation angle as a design parameter, we came to the conclusion that this variation does not have a negative impact on the backside radiation. This is due to the open-ended step that I mentioned that is used to terminate the transmission line.
And sorry, first 5 minutes. Oh, perfect. You're
okay. I'm finishing. Thank you. So you can see that here are the conclusions that we made from our research paper. The radiation between the rotation angle of the coupling slot and the antenna's impedance matching makes the patch element particularly useful for a series FET microstrip patch phased arrays. The proposed design exhibits a linear degradation of the realized gain when rotating the slot with strong roll of from around 70 degrees. And rotation angle has particular useful effect on of reducing the backside radiation at a predictable rate. And here you can see some of the applications that it's possible to use the element. On the right side is the series FET, and on the top is almost the same, but there are two patches that are excited. And yeah, you can read them. So that's all from, if you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer them.
Great, thank you, Diana. Does anybody have any questions? I guess I have a really quick one, and maybe this may be a silly question. I'm sorry, this kind of went a little bit over my head. Really interesting, but has this is the kind of application of this design been kind of thought about being used somewhere in the near future, or is it still kind of in its testing phase?
It's still in a testing phase, but we really wanted to make something that it's like people can use it. So we have an idea to use it for a warehouse inventory tracking. And yeah, we have still some work to do, but it's like a pretty promising design.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Thanks very much. And again, if anybody has any questions, please read it, ask Diana in the chat. Okay, so thanks again.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. So last but not least is Mohamed. Are you ready to go?
Yes.
Great. Thanks so much.
Thank you. I'm going to share my screen.
Yeah. Diana, my dad. Oh, yeah, perfect.
Okay, can you see my screen?
Yeah, looks good.
Okay, perfect. Thank you very much for this opportunity. My name is Mohamed Nedal. I am a second year PhD student at the Institute of Astronomy at the Bulgarian Academy of Sciences. I'm working with Dr. Kamin Kozarev. He is my supervisor, and also working with Dr. Rosit Samikeva, Dr. Oleg Stvanyuk, and Dr. Mom Shilpi. So here I'm going to talk very briefly about what we are currently working on as a team and what I am working on as a PhD student. So the two main projects we are working on are the SpringFast and MosaiX project. And under Mosaics, we are developing a deep learning based model for forecasting the flux of ECBs at one EU. So let's start with the first project, spread fast. So the main idea is to model the synthetic shock waves and the associated ECB acceleration and transport through the heliosphere from active regions. The main objectives are to develop a working prototype framework for data-driven and physics-based modeling for the acceleration and transport of the ECP. Also, for forecasting the flux of the ECB at the Earth. And to prepare parameter tables for shock parameters and properties of the ECB, by modeling some historical events. And to check the performance of the model, we validate out of sample data to check the performance. And finally, we are looking forward to automating this forecasting system. The two points I am interested in working on this project are the working on the observational analysis of shock waves driven by CMEs mainly, and model the associated SEB acceleration and transport using the combination of analytical and numerical based models. And the next step is to try to include the imaging of the associated metric radio bursts, hopefully from lofar stations. And on this link, we can find more information about the project. So what we achieved so far is we successfully characterized the kinematics of 62 coronal shock waves using the CanSHIELD framework and in the both radial outward in the radial direction and the lateral direction. And we used the 3D geometric surface model to create a synthetic shock surface based on these kinematic measurements. And also we used the differential emission measure model of CHOM 2015. So on the left side, we see the an example for the kinematics of event on 7th of June 2011. On the red curve, we see the lateral direction, and the blue curve is the radial direction. Here are the position of the shock wave, the acceleration, speed, thickness, and the intensity of the wave, and also the aspect ratio extrapolated up to 30 arsan. In the middle figures, we have the theta angle, and the shock speed, the density jump, and the upstream magnetic field during the propagation of the shock wave through the magnetic field lines obtained from the mass model results, which is already made the results from MHD runs. And these colored curves represent the magnetic field lines that crossed the shock surface. On the right side, we see on the top a small animation for the front view of the shock wave, and the colors represent the theta angle. And the bottom, we see the shock surface model on the extrapolated magnetic field in the corona. And finally, we compare the particle fluences and particle fluxes obtained from the ERNIE instrument on SOHO satellite with the transport numerical model, every model. And yeah, that's for the spread fast project. And now moving on to the mosaic.
Okay, yeah. Sorry, just 5 minutes, sorry.
And now for the mosaics project, the main two objectives are we are trying to develop a cutting edge software to identify and isolate and extract solar features like the shock waves, filaments, and activations, which is the wave track software. And this work is led by Dr. Oleg Stepanyan. And another thing is to develop and train and test the deep learning models for predicting the SEP flux at the Earth. And this is an example of how the WaveTrack software works. So here in the top left, we see the raw image for the solar disk, and it's gone through multiple stages of pre-processing and decomposition until we successfully isolated or extracted the feature that we are interested in, which is, in this case, is the shockwave here on the top left, or the northeast direction. And for the next part is the deep learning model. Here I'm trying to develop a long short-term memory neural network to forecast the flux of the ACV at three different energy channels using a combination of interplanetary indices and solar indices. And these are the my input parameters. And the input window is for now is 6 days, and the future horizon is 24 hours. So here is the preliminary results for the three energy channels for the data from, I think, 2012 until 2019. And we can see a very close result between the actual data on the blue curve and the prediction from the model with the orange curve. And here we show the mean square error. And here is a looking more closely on the sequences of data. Each sequence represents 24 hours to see how the correlation is. Yes, the model needs more fine tuning. And that's what we are working on. So my conclusion is we successfully characterized 62 UV waves, and we estimated the shock parameters, and we modeled the associated SEP fluxes and fluences, and we are developing and improving feature detection and extraction algorithm. And the next step is trying to include the radio imaging from LOFAR to improve the modeling process. And we are working on fine tuning the model to give better estimations. Yep, I think that's it. Thank you so much.
Great, thank you so much, Mohamed. There was so much there and so much.
Yeah, a lot of details.
Yeah. No, that's a great, maybe we'll ask questions in the chat, just I'm very conscious of time, but I have a few questions for sure.